Yeah, I just had to wait for that one line to get there, Boys Don't Cry, to sort of introduce some of the topics we'll be taking up later in philosophy of gender, just to start to set that up. But in any case, yeah, welcome to another installment of my podcasting ability, which you'll be tired of by the end of the semester. In this case, we'll be probably, you'll be following along with some movie-type scenes, basically, you'll be hearing my voice as well. So let's move along. We'll talk about the key themes in the discourses on the origin of inequality. I'll try to keep it as short as possible. So key things, obviously, are the inequality that is widespread and contemporary, that is, for him, the 18th century society in which he's writing. He's writing, of course, in 1754. The discourse on the origins of inequality were published in 1755. Now, one of his major claims is that there is a human nature, and that we must have a view of this human nature if we are to see just how bad society has gotten. Okay, so in other words, to know where we have reached in society, where things have gone absolutely wrong, and to read the last parts of the Discourse on Inequality is to read an excellent critique of the centralized, almost dictatorial regime of the French monarchy. That is, you had this small number of elite, these noblemen and the king and his courtiers, and the masses in widespread poverty. And when Rousseau is writing this, he's quite obvious about sort of almost the ethical import of his need to write this. Okay, he's responding to this widespread poverty, which he finds egregious. Okay, so there is a human nature, and we must have a view of this human nature if we're to see just how bad society has gotten. That is, we must compare our original nature to its fall, and how this fall has come about over time, as he says, millennia. And it didn't happen overnight, he says. This happened the time from the beginning of man to the contemporary society he sees in the 18th century is quite vast. The thing that I want to just underline here is that it is quite important to understand that Rousseau is not just perspicuous or relevant for his own age, but I think also for ours. We have to step back and question what it means for technology in our own age. Does science, with all the wonders that it's given us, but also knowledge about the universe, has us improved our lot? Okay, and Rousseau is basically focused on this. Okay, so what I'll cover in this QuickTime movie is, first of all, Rousseau's life, then secondly, the background against which Rousseau was writing, that is, previous philosophers, such as Thomas Hobbes and John Locke, but also the age of the Enlightenment, and I'll also cover key sections of the text to go over while you are reading. He was born in 1712 in Geneva, which is now in Switzerland, of course. There it is. Okay, and Geneva was then a republic, and Rousseau was proud to call himself, throughout his life, a citizen of Geneva. Well, not all of his life. There was a period in 1762 to 1765 where he was quite discouraged by the fact that the citizens of Geneva basically were burning his books. That is, a social contract that he published in 1762. But here, of course, in the Discourse on the Origins of Inequality, you'll see here that the first English translation calls him John James Rousseau, citizen of Geneva. So I thought I'd like to put that out there. He was not John James, Jean-Jacques Rousseau, but it's an Anglicization of his name. He calls himself a citizen of Geneva. He was raised a Protestant in Geneva early in his life, but then converted to Catholicism, as we'll discuss in a bit. And so therefore, when he was writing this in 1754, he wasn't actually a citizen of Geneva. He was born in 1712, as I've said. He was the second son of Isaac Rousseau, a watchman. His father brought him up after his mother died in childbirth, which, as Rousseau wrote in his Confessions, was to haunt him with guilt for the rest of his life. For 10 years, Isaac raised Rousseau, but he fled in 1722 after a fight. That is, that's Isaac. So he has a fight. The circumstances are a bit mysterious, but he flees. Rousseau was then sent to stay with a cousin for a few years. Upon returning to Geneva, Rousseau was an apprentice to an engraver who abused Rousseau. Rousseau, again, talks about this in his autobiography, The Confessions, at quite a bit of length. Rousseau is actually a little bit gentle on him, but it's quite clear that this man physically abused Rousseau and treated him quite horribly in a lot of other ways as well, constantly insulting him and stuff. But these lonely beginnings, I think, taught Rousseau quite a bit about the plight of the lower classes. In 1728, of course, he's quite dissatisfied with his own life. He's getting basically beaten by his boss, to whom he's an apprentice. Rousseau took the chance to leave Geneva when he was locked outside of the city walls one night in 1728. This is a picture of the city walls as they still exist today. So he's locked out. All the cities in Europe, basically, during this time, would lock up the walls at night. They were sort of land pirates who would come around and steal from you if you didn't sort of lock up at night the way you lock up your house today. He sought help from some Catholic priests who sent him famously to the Baron de Warn, who made a living converting young men like Rousseau to Catholicism. It helped that she's usually described as somewhat beautiful older woman. It's not clear from other descriptions, though, whether she was actually this or just simply getting the right kind of sort of embarrassed young men who would she could take under her wing. They had quite a close relationship, in fact, and this repeats. Sorry about that. But in any case, having converted to Catholicism with Madame de Warn, he was no longer a citizen of Geneva. Okay, she sent him to Turin, now in Italy, for Catholic training, and in one particularly painful episode, again, this is recounted as an autobiography, Rousseau stole a ribbon and put the blame on it. I don't know why he stole a ribbon, but in any case, he steals a ribbon and puts the blame on a servant girl where he was working. She was fired, and he later left in shame. He never forgave himself, and many, many years later, he writes in the Confessions about this at length. So this becomes sort of a memorable episode. So Rousseau, later in life, was obviously very keen to write about every sort of embarrassing episode that he had been involved in. Rousseau returned to live with Madame de Warn in 1731. She called him Petit, and he called her Maman. That is, he called her basically the French version of Mom, or Ma. But he left no doubt about his crush for this mother figure. It's almost incestuous. She's an older woman. She's some 16, 17 years his senior. And in 1733, he does become his lover, consummating an infatuation that lasted from the moment he had met her. And if you read the Confessions, he goes on at length about the love that he had for her. Rousseau remained an avid reader, laying the groundwork for his later writings. And I should say from 1733 to 1738, he does have this relationship with Madame de Warren. This ends in 1738 because basically she had taken up with another man, and Rousseau finally figures this out. She was sort of having it both ways. She was both with Rousseau and this other man. This other man knew, but Rousseau had no idea he was part of a menage a trois, and so he sort of ends it. He leaves for Paris. And he makes it, he doesn't leave for Paris initially, but he ends up making it to Paris by 1742. He publishes some work on music. In fact, along the way, he had become somewhat of an itinerant music maker. And if you know the play that I'm referencing, or the musical that I'm referencing, you get just how good of a musician Rousseau was. He actually wasn't a very good one. In terms of actually knowing notation or anything like that, he never really learned it. But it turns out later on that his music was sort of memorizable and memorable, and so he did publish some works on music, and he became later famous in the 1750s for an opera he wrote, The Village Soothsayer. In 1742, he also becomes an assistant to the French ambassador in Venice. Again, he sort of learns up close about the elite, both in Paris and elsewhere, and in Venice as well. The ambassador is portrayed in the Confessions as quite a stupid man, and I've no doubt that he probably was. It was during this time that Rousseau married Thérèse Levasseur, who was to bear him actually several children during the 1740s. All of these children, by the way, were to be placed in foundling homes, that is, orphanages, something Rousseau's critics never forgave him for. And in fact, 1740s, when Rousseau is sort of making it to the upper echelon of the elite in Paris, the intellectual elite in Paris, this rumors are making the rounds. And in fact, in the Confessions, finally Rousseau admits to this, but, I mean, there was rumors that he had scores of children in a family home. I guess maybe more than one is unacceptable or something like that, but still. This tore probably Thérèse apart, although we don't have any writings from her on the topic. It was during this time that Rousseau also engaged in the highly important philosophical scene in Paris. You have Voltaire writing, you have Diderot writing, you have all of these philosophes writing at this time during the great era of the French Enlightenment. This is the return to rationalism, and it's a time of a questioning of previous values. That is, Enlightenment was all about rationalism. Enlightenment By the way, the term Enlightenment only came later on, but these Lumières, they were called these enlightened ones, were keen to put out and to understand all of human knowledge. So one of their projects, of course, was the Encyclopedia. There were other projects underway. The first Encyclopedia, sort of, we don't have the Funk and Wagnalls and all that around, or Encyclopedia Britannica around today, but imagine something like an early version of the Internet. And you get somewhat of an idea, a place where all knowledge could be found. Okay, and so this is a highly rational era, or at least believes itself to be. When Diderot was placed in prison, he was placed in prison by the king for supposedly being an atheist, which he was. He wrote Candide, of course. Rousseau went to visit him, and this is in 1749, and along the way Rousseau found out about an essay contest that was to be awarded by the, or be presided over by the Academy of Dijon, asking whether or not the sciences and the arts had improved the ethics or morality of man. And Rousseau responds affirmatively, or negatively, no. The question is, has our technological and scientific improvements made us better human beings? This is a question we should always be willing to ask. And Rousseau's answer is no, that over time, in fact, all the arts and sciences have given us is a way to further our vanity, and that we're better off in the earlier ages of man. Of course, Rousseau will come back to this theme in part one of the Second Discourse. Okay, but in any case, we were better off in our savage state than we were in contemporary society, where medicine and technology had only weakened us. This essay actually wins the prize from the Academy of Dijon, which the 1754 Discourse on the Origins of Inequality would not. It's important to note that in 1750, Rousseau makes his name. He wins this prize. He's relatively unknown as a philosopher, but this becomes gains him both fame and infamy. Diderot, the friend that he was visiting, Denis Diderot, argued that he had given up on reason, and that, in fact, Rousseau was arguing against the prized advancement of knowledge during this age. Because Rousseau was saying, what good has it done us? It hasn't done us any good. It's made us weaker. Rousseau seemed to argue that human beings were better off without reason, yet other Enlightenment age thinkers argued that it was reason that was saving us from what they called barbarism, saving us from superstition, saving us from false beliefs, and astrology, and all of the things that we know from the early Renaissance, and would lead, hopefully, and they certainly had this hope, to better society. So if we shake off this barbarism, these superstitions, we can become civilized. So Rousseau would soon, this is still the early 1750s, would publish his opera Le Devant du Village, which would gain him the village soothsayer, would gain him the attention of the king, who offered Rousseau a pension, in which Rousseau famously just turned down. I think he would come to regret this, because he would have constant troubles in this later years coming up with money. And in fact, if he had taken this pension, he might have been offered some protection from the king when he wrote his later works. But this did give him the independence he sought, and this also tells you something of his view, even in 1750, too, when this offer is made, about the king, the elite, and joining them. In 1754, Rousseau enters another essay contest. This one he lost. This is a 1754 essay that he writes and that we're reading. Okay. And so after publishing the Discourse on the Origins of Inequality in 1755, Rousseau took up his Protestant faith again, and could only now, in 1755, become a citizen of Geneva. So he writes this really overflowing preface to the Discourse on the Origins of Inequality to his fellow citizens of Geneva, this wonderful place that marks the pinnacle of human civilization, human regard for others, and so on. And he's not actually a citizen there, but he would be able to take up his citizenship again in 1755. Geneva just had a law against non-Protestants being citizens. Soon Rousseau would publish Emile, his great work on education. This is published in 1762. Also published in 1762 is On the Social Contract, which argued for a correct social contract between citizens who would govern themselves. What Rousseau really does is take a lot of the arguments that he's going to make in part two of the Discourse on the Origins of Inequality. That is, we ought to be governed not by an aristocracy, not by an elite, not by those who have more property, but find a way that the general will, or the The rule of the people can come to the fore. That's what the social contract is about. A correct contract between each member of society such that there is a greatest amount of freedom and equality. And this freedom and equality, he says, we find generally in the state of nature in terms of an absolute freedom but one that we can't really use in certain ways because we don't have reason or language and so on. We'll get into this. It was a revolutionary book, and Rousseau begins by arguing that all men are born free, and yet everywhere men are in chains. And this becomes a famous line that is repeated again and again leading up to the French Revolution. A lot of the French revolutionary thinkers, including the Abbé Dissès, were influenced by the social contract and read it again and again, and a lot of the phrases from there became sort of mantras during the French Revolutionary period. Rousseau then argued that each of us has a right to revolt if our government oppresses us, and he issues similar lines in part two of the Discourse on Inequality. After 1764, Rousseau gained infamy for his arguments in Emile and on the social contract that were wrongly construed by many as anti-religious. He argues therefore what he calls a civic religion. That is, how do we keep people together? We do that by having them have a common belief in a God. And this was thought to be cynical, that this is all religion is a way to keep people together. And since he doesn't mention Christianity in particular, it's thought that he's being anti-Christian and perhaps even atheistic. So his books were banned, they were burned, and in fact the citizens of Geneva were among those burning his books. And to say the least, Rousseau was a thin-skinned man, and he did not take the criticism at all well. Perhaps none of us would, given that he was being chased around and, you know, people were throwing rocks at his, literally through the windows of his home and so on. So he grew more and more paranoid in the 1760s, and frankly grew kind of mad. And it's not clear whether this was a mental breakdown or whether, you know, frankly, a form of mercury poisoning, or who knows, lead poisoning, who knows. And something was affecting his mind, certainly in the 1760s. He does begin his Confessions. It is a great work to read. He sets out in the Confessions to write the story of his life with as much truth as he could possibly do with his memory. And the reason he writes it is to sort of bat off the worst of the rumors around him by replacing them by pretty, you know, awful stories about himself, but nevertheless not nearly as bad as the rumors that were going around. He did read the parts of the confession to female paramours and others whose money he needed to make a living for him and Thérèse. I should say that the confessions, however, didn't get published until after his death. Strangely, in 1776, 2 years before he dies, he has an incident with a dog, and this who knocks him over violently, and this seemed to fix him of some of his madness. In his last 2 years, he wrote a lovely work on the beauty of nature, The Reveries of a Solitary Walker, which I wholly recommend. But he also wrote reflections on the Polish Constitution. He wrote several works that were very clear-headed, not full of sort of the passions and almost paranoia of the earlier works. I should say, I do like the works of the paranoid Rousseau as well, but certainly these are much more clear-headed. So in 1778, Rousseau would pass away, and it wasn't until 1800 that Thérèse would die. Rousseau, during the French Revolution, as you can see to the right, was buried, had his grave moved to the Pantheon in Paris. This tells you the great esteem that the revolutionaries in Paris at the time held for Rousseau, and his body still remains in state there today. By the way, Thérèse refused burial next to him, although I believe her remains are there, next to his as well. And she became somewhat of a hero during the French Revolution because she's tied to Rousseau, and she tried to hide as much as possible. And it should be said that after Rousseau, she married a commoner, and so she was not taking up with any more famous men. So in any case, as you can see, his writings were quite a force in for the revolutionaries, the same way that in some sense, and this is a bad analogy, the works of Malcolm X would be very fruitful and used by the Black Panther movement of the 1960s, the ways in which the writings of Frantz Fanon, which we'll take up, became works read and reread by revolutionaries across the world after he wrote them in the 1950s. So he had quite an effect on later revolutionary thought, including the work of Marx. I think there's a lot to write about the link between Marx's ideas of alienation, Marx's ideas of economic history, and those of Rousseau. But that is not to reduce Rousseau to simply being a proto-Marxist. Rousseau's work is too complicated that, and in fact, Marx's is too. But in any case, Rousseau begins the discourse on inequality by arguing that arguing about all the difficulty in getting back to this state of nature. Recall the statue of Glaucus, right? This analogy to the this figure of Glaucus that is a monster, this sea, this man who's changed into a sea monster who's then frozen in stone, and now has been degraded over time. And so how are we to look at this figure of Glaucus? Look at the second paragraph of the introduction to the discourse on the inequality. You know, this is, he talks about this figure of Glaucus, and he's talking about, well, how do we get to that that beginning man? How do we get, and by analogy, how do we get back to the state of nature? Well, it's obviously going to be extremely difficult. Okay, but Rousseau begins by arguing that of all the human sciences, the most useful and the most imperfect appears to me to be that of mankind. And I will venture to say, the single inscription on the Temple of Delphi contains a precept more difficult and more important than is to be found anywhere else. Okay, so in other words, what he's saying is that the Temple of Delphi, the phrase over the Temple of Delphi, the inscription is, "Know thyself, Gnothesaiton." And Rousseau is saying, look, this is what we need to do. We need to know what man is if we were to know what kind of political regime we should have. Okay, and this will be echoed somewhat by Freud and Civilization, Its Discontents, and in some sense by Fanon and all later writers. They have an idea of what human nature is, and then they prescribe or describe the kind of politics, the kind of political regimes that we would need. Okay, so again, turning to this figure of Glaucus on page 10, like the statue of Glaucus, which was so disfigured by time, seas, and tempests, he writes, that it looked more like a wild beast than a god, the human soul altered in a society by a thousand causes, perpetually recurring, by the acquisition of a multitude of truth and errors, by the changes happening to the constitution of the body, by the continual jarring of the passions, has, so to speak, changed in appearance so as to be hardly recognizable. And so we can never fully see our human nature from within society. And this is an extremely important point. Basically, Rousseau is saying, look, my task here is to provide a hypothetical history that gets us to the origins of human society. Okay, but he calls it hypothetical. And it's important that he does call it hypothetical, because that warns us that he's not providing a strict history. In fact, he says, we must set all facts aside. So why does he use this hypothesis? Why does he do this? Well, because it's the best guess he can have for what nature is, so that he can argue against other state of nature theorists and say, look, this is how society should be. This is how we should order our society. So he says, we have entered upon certain arguments and risked some conjectures. Again, this is not a work of science. This is not a work of real history. Less in the hope of solving the difficulty than with a view of throwing some light upon it and reducing the question, that is, what is the origin of equality, to its proper form. He says, others may proceed farther on the same road. This is a little bit of modesty on his part. And yet no one find it very easy to get to the end, that is, exactly to the origin of inequality. Okay? For it is by no means a light undertaking to distinguish properly between what is original, that is, what is an original state of nature, what we originally were before societies began, and what is artificial, that is, what is created in societies in the actual nature of man, or to form a true idea of a state which no longer exists, perhaps never did exist. We must underline that, perhaps never did exist. So Rousseau is telling us, this state of nature which I'm about to describe perhaps never existed, but it's a useful device of by reason, it's a useful device by him to get at how we should live today, right? So if he can think about what we might be in a state of nature, this provides a useful fiction for him to provide us with a political theory. Okay. So to form a true idea of a man, a true idea of a state of which no longer exists, perhaps never did exist, and probably will never exist, and of which it is nevertheless necessary to have true ideas in order to form a proper judgment of our present state. What experiments would have to be made to discover the natural man, and how are those experiments to be made in a state of society, he asks. Thus here Rousseau argues against the idea of natural law, that is, that human beings ought to resign themselves in some way to a particular station in life because of God. Now this is Rousseau's way of putting it. There are a lot of natural law theorists, indeed until today, following in some sense back to Cicero's views of the laws of nature and natural law, following Catholic theologians of the Middle Ages, including Thomas Aquinas, writing in The City of God. This has quite a a good intellectual pedigree, but Rousseau is arguing against this. Look, the political state we have does not need to be this way. It is completely contingent on history. It could have been otherwise. That is going to be the crux of his argument, that it didn't need to be this way. It wasn't necessary. Because others are arguing, yes, this is the way it should be. This is the way it ought to be. We ought to have this great difference between the wealthy few and the starving masses. That this is the way God intended it, and if the masses are unhappy, don't worry, they'll have heaven and life to save them. So turning to pages 16 to 17, Rousseau notes there are two kinds of inequality. The first is natural inequality. These are differences between each of us in the state of nature in terms of how strong we are, how big our body is, and so on, how quick we can be. Okay, we all recognize that we have some forms of natural inequality, and what he calls moral inequality. And this sounds all ethical and everything, but what he really means by that is the inequalities that are given to us in society. And in society, we have differences in intelligence, we have differences in reason, we have differences, most perspicuously, of wealth and of property. These are moral inequalities, and these are very different from natural inequalities. And the task of Rousseau is to show how one does not follow from the other. Moral inequality does not follow from the other. So Rousseau will argue that moral inequality does not simply come from natural inequalities. Is the king of France so far and away stronger and more intelligent to have so much power? On page 18, Rousseau waxes quite passionately about the text. He writes, "Oh man, of whatever country you are and whatever your opinions may be, behold your history, such as I have thought to read it, not in books written by your fellow creatures, who are liars, but in nature, which never lies. All that comes from her will be true, nor will you meet with anything false, unless I have involuntarily put in something of my own." So here he's trying to say that through this weird fiction, he's trying to tell you the truth of our history. "The times of which I'm going to speak are very remote," he goes on. "How much you changed from what you once were. It is, so to speak, the life of your species which I am going to write, after the qualities which you have received, which your education and habits may have depraved, but cannot have entirely destroyed." So he's saying there's still a trace of this within us. "There is, I feel, an age at which the individual man would wish to stop." You're about to inquire about the age at which you would have liked your whole species to stand still. So if we were going to pick a stage at which human development should have stopped and gone no farther, Rousseau asks, what would it be? Have we reached that point? Perhaps we've reached it in the past. Rousseau is going to argue that, in fact, there may have been a point in the very distant past that we would have stopped. "So in any case, discontented with your present state," he goes on, "for reasons which threaten your unfortunate descendants with still greater discontent, you will perhaps wish it were in your power to go back, and this feeling should be a panegyric on your first ancestors," that is, a homily to them, "a criticism of your contemporaries, because look at how bad it is now, and yet these simple men of the past had it so well, and a terror to the unfortunates who will come after you." And this last line is important, "and a terror to the unfortunates who will come after you," because Rousseau is saying it's only going to get worse. Take special note of how Rousseau describes human beings in the state of nature. Be sure to note that human beings in the state of nature are without reason and language, without even clothing or even the shame to wear clothing. We know the story of Genesis. He's sort of rewriting it here. Adam and Eve, after eating of the fruit of knowledge, feel shame at their nakedness. "And strong and without need of technology," and don't have it anyway. But they are strong, they can climb trees to get the fruits that they need. They have no need of all this technology, which Rousseau believes has actually just made us weaker. And be sure to note the other faculties that these earliest of human beings have. Be sure to note, first and foremost, the two fundamental instincts that man has, that of self-preservation and the instinct of pity. Okay? This is very different from what Thomas Hobbes, writing in the 17th century, described as the state of nature, where life was, as he said, nasty, brutish, and short. What does Rousseau argue? What was life in the state of nature like for Rousseau? This is a picture from the of Johnny Depp in the Pirates movie. These are called Caribs, I think, in the film, and so, strange enough, you can see how they're depicted. We'll take up this more in what Edward Said calls Orientalism. So note on page 21, in the footnotes, Rousseau's descriptions of the Caribs of Venezuela. So we'll take up how the others of Europe have always stood in for primitives. This we'll take up this further later on in the class. What does this mean for the way Europeans viewed the native peoples of Latin America and Africa as well? Note also on page 21 at the bottom that these people die without ever being aware of it. this is important because this is also what philosophers say about animals. So the people in the state of nature, they have no memory and no concept of the future, and therefore no concept of death, that they are mortal and going to die. They simply live their life. They go out, they eat, they copulate, they defecate, and so on, and go to sleep under the same tree, or perhaps a different tree at night. It does not matter. Okay, on page 22, Rousseau turns towards the inequalities of the present day, that is, in 1754 when he's writing. The extreme inequality in our lifestyle, excessive idleness among some, excessive labor among others, the ease with which we arouse and satisfy our appetites and our sensuality. So, for the wealthy few, they have all of these things. I guess the wealthy, it's not just the wealthy few that can have Cheetos or Doritos or whatever I have pictured over there. And he talks about the overly refined foods of the wealthy, which nourish them with irritating juices and overwhelm them with indigestion. So he even suggests that they have these great foods, but in some sense it's not helping them either. Better return to the simple diet of the quote-unquote noble savage versus the bad food of the poor, if and when they have it. Okay, so their stomachs, the poor's stomachs are empty, and yet you have these wealthy few gorging themselves on all sorts of foods. On page 23, Rousseau says, we must take care not to confuse savage men with the men we have before our eyes, that is, the men of the contemporary society. Why not? He argues that human beings have become domesticated. What does he mean by this term? Right? Remember, by analogy, this you usually say that animals are domesticated. What happens to an animal when you domesticate it? What happens to a human being when you domesticate it? On page 24, Rousseau turns to the noble savage in the state of nature, that is, human beings as they were before any society. And I use this term, noble savage, because it's often used with regard to Rousseau. I should say that he never uses that term. Note how his descriptions here are completely different. Okay, how? On page 24, just going through the page by page, this is what I'll probably do for each of the podcasts, just move page by page or by groups of chapters to go over what you sort of want to pay attention to. Rousseau argues that what differentiates human beings from animals is that human beings have what he calls a perfectibility. That is, we have always this freedom and attempt to better ourselves. Animals are nothing but machines, he says. Page 26 to 27, Rousseau argues that savage man lives by instinct. So we have instinct, and we have this perfectibility that we haven't sort of activated yet, but we will. On page 27, he talks about the differences between living in the North and the South. This is Rousseau's idea, again, of the noble savage. He says, Europe is hyper-civilized, too civilized, and it's needed to be because we need all this technology in order to farm very unsuitable land. But in the South, food is plenty, he suggests. The climate is warm, so there's not very much thinking that goes on there. Again, there is an implicit, obvious differentiation of races or what have you between those of the North, namely Europe, and those of the South, namely those of Africans and Latin America. So note how on page 27 it takes for these changes he discusses to occur. It's a long timeline. So this doesn't happen overnight. It's sort of like Darwin's theory of evolution. Every little step takes millions upon millions of years, right, in Darwinian theory. And the same for Rousseau. But the important thing in Rousseau is that these are going to be innocent steps. So things that we, in isolation, look like a good thing, that we begin to get shelter, or that we begin to dance, or develop music, or language, or we begin to help one another, leads to dependence, leads to inequality, leads to showmanship, and so on, that further degrade man and lead him away from this primitive, quote-unquote, but noble state. On page 28, note Rousseau's first critiques of philosophy. Why is it useless to the man in the state of nature? Now, of course, there's some irony at work, because Rousseau is doing something of a work of philosophy. He's doing something of a work of reason. But what he says is the philosopher is able to basically shut out this natural pity that we have, okay, to reason it away, right? He says at one point, you know, somebody could be being killed in the alleyway outside the philosopher's home, and the philosopher will look out and reason, close his ears, and reason it away. On page 29, Rousseau provides his idea of romance in the state of nature. His argument essentially is that the family unit and any family values are not natural, although he says, you know, this is a wonderful thing. But in the state of nature, males and females, he writes, just come together fortuitously. That is, you know, there's a woman over there, There's a man over here. They have to meet up. They have conjugal relations, and then they leave each other. That's really about it. As he says, without there being any great need for words to express, so not exactly any romance there. And they just left one another with the same nonchalance. So you copulate and move on. Okay. On page 31, Rousseau discusses the origins of language, and our first language was really that of the cry. From there, we invented words that represented whole sentences and then moved on to forming a whole vocabulary. Again, this seems like innocent steps, but here we get the first developments of reason, the first separation between subjects and objects, and the differentiations between objects. And this differentiation allows us to say which is better and which is worse. Okay, and we need this in order to form any idea of inequality, to form any idea that someone is better than another. The words that we formed helped us to move farther in our imagination, our use of imagination, and more words were invented along the way. This is important because what's going to happen is our imagination, which we take to be a good thing, that we can imagine a better life for ourselves and thus can move towards it, Rousseau argues in some sense, no, this is not exactly a great thing, because what our imagination allows us to do is imagine more pernicious ways of treating other human beings. But in any case, it is necessary, he writes on page 32, to utter sentences and thus to speak in order to have general ideas. So around the time language develops, we first get speech and then we get ideas. Okay. On page 30, in the state of nature, human beings have everything they need. There is no scarcity. Okay. So this is usually a question that I get when I teach this book. Well, you know, why aren't they going to fight? Why aren't they going to fight over apples? Well, there's no need to. Because everything is provided. In instinct alone, he writes, man had everything he needed in order to live in the state of nature. In a cultivated reason, he has only what he needs to live in society. Now, the big distinction that Rousseau is attempting to make here on page 30 is, in the state of nature, we had everything we wanted. Okay? All we needed was food, we needed air, and perhaps a tree to sleep under if it was raining and made us uncomfortable. By the time we get to society, especially today, our needs have expanded well beyond anything that anybody in the state of nature would ever have wanted, needed, or even could begin to conceptualize. We say we need our iPhones, that we need our iPods, I'm really selling Macintosh here, that we need our books, or whatever it is that we say that we need, and we take to be necessities. In fact, we don't need, that the man in the state of nature could survive quite easily without. And it's perhaps true today that we've been weakened to such a point, Rousseau might say, that we need these prosthetics, we need these technological additions to help us survive. On page 34, Rousseau turns to his critique of Hobbes. Above all, let us not conclude with Hobbes, he writes, that because man has no idea of goodness, he must be naturally wicked, that he is vicious because he does not know virtue, that he always refuses to do his fellow creatures services which he does not think they have a right to demand, or that by virtue of the right he truly claims to everything he needs. He foolishly imagined himself the sole proprietor of the whole universe. No, no, no. What Rousseau will say is that Hobbes is seeing how men act competitively in this, let's just call it a barbarous society, in contemporary barbarous society. He sees how people steal from one another, that we, in Hobbes' example, look, we know that men were competitive in the state of nature. Why? Because, look, none of us leaves our cupboards, that's the example he does use, but our doors locked, unlocked, and leave the house, so we know what we think of other men. And Rousseau says, yes, that's what happens in this society, but do not export that, do not take that and take to be our plight in the state of nature. This did not exist. Okay. He writes, but the consequences which he deduces, that is Hobbes, from his own show that he understands it in an equally false sense. In reasoning on the principle he lays down, he ought to have said that the state of nature, being that in which the care for our own preservation is the least prejudicial to that of others, was consequently the best calculated to promote peace and the most suitable for mankind. Contra Hobbes, or against Hobbes, Rousseau will basically say, without scarcity, why will we, and wanting our own self-preservation, which Hobbes says we do have, why would we fight one another? That only might cause us injury. If we want self-preservation, we would just simply avoid the other person. We would avoid conflict. We would avoid fights. And yet Hobbes says in the state of nature, this is all that happens. Life is nasty, brutish, and short. He goes on. Hobbes does say the exact opposite in consequence of having improperly admitted, as part of savage man's care for self-preservation, the gratification of a multitude of passions which are the work of society. These passions are the work of society and have made laws necessary. A bad man, he says, is a robust child. So the laws are necessary for Hobbes because we've become competitive. Rousseau says laws came, in some sense, as part of the flight into society, but they were only necessary because society had created inequality, had created the vanity, had created all of the problems that Hobbes wants to solve and sees in the state of nature, but which did not exist there. And basically Rousseau says, look, if you want to understand human nature in a sense, well, look, we have this care for self-preservation, but what Hobbes misses, we also have a natural pity, okay? And he says, we can see this in the way that cows look away when other cows are taken to the slaughterhouse. When you hear the moans of cows, others turn away. And from stories I've heard from some people who've been to slaughterhouses, they say this does actually happen. Such, he writes, is the pure movement of nature prior to all reflection. So Rousseau really does have this fixation on the beauty, the purity of nature. Okay, that is, prior to all reflection, prior to all reason, we have this natural pity. And it's reflection, it's reason that tells us, look, that is not me getting killed. Okay, and he says, basically, if you want to think about our friendships today, they're basically constant forms of pity that have been hashed out. Finally, Rousseau argues that even the greatest use of reason only causes more harm than good. It is philosophy that isolates him, he writes, and bids him say, at sight of the misfortune of others, perish if you will, I am secure. Okay, so, like he says, a murder may be committed with impunity underneath somebody's windows. The philosopher simply closes up his ears and says, that is not me. Okay, that guy is unfortunate, but it is not I. I make a separation from the other person. The person in the state of nature, however, feels this innate pity, and as long as his own survival is not threatened, does as much as he can. Okay, so there are two natural feelings for in the state of nature. These are self-preservation and pity at the suffering of others. Okay, on page 38, he declares the maxim of the savage is this: do what is good for you with as little harm as possible to others. Right, so this puts these two initial instincts together. On page 39, Rousseau turns to the sentiment of love. There's a physical aspect, which we of course all know, which Rousseau notes, and there's also this moral aspect, or the one that we enjoy in society. It is this one that leads to vanity and to jealousy. So of course there's no jealousy in the state of nature, because Rousseau suggests, look, there are plenty of women. And again, here you see women reduced to simple objects for the gaze of men, sexual objects, right, to be picked up and tossed aside. But there's no jealousy there. There's no competition over women. It's only as society begins to develop, only when families begin to develop, as men wanted to take ownership over women, take them back into the house, that you want to take the best woman for this longer period of time, that you want to dance better, as he literally says this, that we want to dance better and show off. And so we start wearing better clothing and so on, and jealousy then becomes rampant. Okay, so there are just so many women, so why bother? So there's no reason for this competition or jealousy in the state of nature. In fact, Rousseau says, look, in these chance encounters in the state of nature, we'll just simply, men will take anybody. How much that has changed from nights, Friday nights at the bar, I don't know. So on page 41, Rousseau summarizes his arguments from part one, and I'll let you read that on your own. Okay, and so moving on, the beginning of part two marks the beginning of the fall. Okay, or actually marks the end of the beginning of the fall. And let me read this carefully. The first man who, having enclosed a piece of ground, bethought himself of saying, this is mine, and found people simple enough to believe him, was the real founder of civil society. Let me pause here. So he basically begins part two by saying, the founder of civil society is that person who takes out a stick, puts a border somewhere in the sand or in the dirt, and says, hey, this is my property. That's the founder of civil society. Because that's the person who says, this is mine, and you have nothing, or you have very little. And once you can declare property, you have automatic inequality, because different property, different properties are going to have different sizes, and so on. And so this person is the founder of civil society. And notice how Rousseau makes this out to be sort of an accident of history. This is mine, and found people simple, stupid enough to believe it. Right? So somebody comes along and says, look, this is my property, and somebody else goes, oh, okay, and simply walks away. And Rousseau says, if that incident didn't happen, that perhaps we would still be living in a way, we'd be living in this very different way, right? It's simply somebody had declared, as he says in the middle of this paragraph, beware of listening to this imposter. You are undone if you once forget that the fruits of the earth belong to us all, and the earth itself to nobody. He is paraphrasing, of course, part of the New Testament there. The fruits of the earth belong to all. Okay, so he's saying, if somebody had just done that, we might have never gone down this road that we see today, where people say, like, you know, Bill Gates can say, you know, I have $70 billion in property or something like that, and yet this is more than the wealth of, you know, say 25% of the rest of the world. So your task in part two is to trace out how this final step came about. How do we get to this property, right? And this is going to happen through several stages: the appearance of family life, the appearance of semi-property in terms of houses, the appearance of agricultural metallurgy, the appearance of special skills, which gives some people an advantage over others, and then further property increases and so on, and then finally the advent of a form of proto-capitalism in terms of money and so on. And this is how inequality finally comes about. So you want to ask, how did agriculture rise up? What is the role of metallurgy, that is the creation of tools from metal? How do comparisons and vanity begin? And why, finally, did someone feel the need to invent property? If you can explain this, then you're in a good way ahead in your reading of the Discourse on Inequality. I'm just going to wrap it up there, but I want you to pay attention also to those last few pages. I think they're quite clear in Rousseau's critique of contemporary society, that is in 1754, the differences between the wealthy and the poor, and starts to set out what he'll finally complete, the task that he'll finally complete for himself in 1762, namely, what is the proper social contract, and why is this contract, or this society that we live in, null and void? Why does the contract we live under null and void? Well, because it takes away our freedoms and gives us nothing back in return. It's made us simply slaves. And so Rousseau, even in 1754, is going to be quite controversial for his time and call for revolution in those places where we were completely unequal. Okay, well, for now, this is all that I have. But if you have any questions, of course, get in touch with me. Thanks.